We'll try this again.
Good morning, everyone. Let's all rise. Let's sing together this first song.
Through the rain.
morning, everyone, and welcome to Rally Day as we kick off the new fall season for FUMC. It's good to have both services together and to see some faces that I don't normally see, and hopefully you find the same thing. So a few announcements I'd like to call your attention to. The sign up for church photo book is still underway. If you have not yet signed up for that, you can do so after this service in Friendship Center. Bonnie will be out there taking names of people who have not yet signed up, and she's also looking for people to help as hosts or hostesses for the various sessions that polls will be taken. So please see Bonnie today or call the church office if you have not yet signed up. It's important to get everyone to participate in this photo directory. I know I use it a lot. Also, Pastor Leah is going to be having lunch for people that are interested in learning more about our church and or how to become a member. That starts on Sunday, October 14th at 12:15. If you're interested in that, please contact Sharon in the office. And it will be an opportunity for those of you who have been visiting or maybe new to our church to learn more about it, perhaps decide to become a member. Then I remind you to fill out the yellow sheet that's in your bulletin to indicate your attendance and put as much information on there as you care to share. Now let's take a moment and greet those around us. If you see someone from a service you don't normally attend, make an effort to welcome them to my service.
Rejoice! Rejoice!
Please join me in the congregational prayer. O God, I offer this year as it opens before me. Invest its ideas with your energy, its events with your possibilities, its encounters with your presence, that in it heaven and earth may collide and your kingdom abounds.
There's got to be more than going back and forth and living right and doing wrong. We were taught that who we are, come on, get in line, not behind. You along with everybody, thinking there's worth in what you do. Then like a hero who takes the stage when
mountains. our highest mountain in Northern Hawaii. But for the most part, we've got hills, we've got a lot of flat plains. We're in a flat plain, there's some rolling prairies, but not too many mountains. But in the Bible, mountains played an important role. In the Bible, God often spoke to or communicated with his people on mountains, on mountaintops. In the Old Testament, think about Moses. He was on a mountain that God spoke to Moses for the first time from a burning bush, and he said, go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. Remember that? And then it was later on a mountain that Moses spent quite a bit of time with God, and God spoke to Moses on that mountain and gave him the Ten Commandments, which he then was able to give to his people, the Israelites, and to the whole world to show us how to live to please God and honor him. And then it was on a mountain that the prophet Elijah, and this is a goosebump story, so you need to read the stories in 1 Kings. The prophet Elijah, God spoke through power by sending fire down from heaven and burning up the sacrifice that Elijah had put on the altar to prove that God is the only true God. And then again, it was on a mountain later on that God spoke to Elijah again when Elijah was running scared from some bad people who were trying to kill him. And God told him then, are you okay? Because I'm still in control. And then we think about the New Testament. We think about all the times that Jesus went up on a mountaintop, on a mountainside, to get away from the crowds and to have quiet time with God, his Father, to pray to him, to talk to him. In fact, we think of the Sermon on the Mount, called the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus was on a mountainside teaching thousands of people, boys and girls, as well as men and women, all about God. And that we call the Sermon on the Mount because it was a mountainside. And then another goosebump story in Matthew 17, where Jesus takes three of his disciples, takes Peter, James, and John, up on the top of this mountain. And on top of this mountain, Jesus is changed right in front of their eyes. He looks different. He is transfigured. The Bible says his face was shining like the sun. Now think about how bright the sun is. And his clothes were so bright, they were as bright as light or lightning. That's pretty bright. And then, on either side of him appear Elijah and Moses, those two guys I talked about earlier from the Old Testament. They came down from heaven to talk to Jesus on this mountaintop about what he was going to be going through in Jerusalem. So God spoke, and God spoke then to the disciples. The disciples were witnessing this, and they didn't know what to think. And God spoke to them from that mountain, on that mountaintop, and said, this is my son whom I love. Listen to him. With an exclamation mark. Listen to him. And then, later on, we do know that, you know what happened to Jesus? It was on a mountainside, or a mountain outside of Jerusalem, that he was put on a cross. He was crucified, he died. But then again, and God was speaking to everyone in the world on that mountain, on that cross. But then again, after he rose again, and he spent time with the disciples teaching them some more, then he went to a mountaintop outside of Jerusalem, and he gave them one last instruction before he left. He spoke to them and he said, go and tell everyone in your city about me. Tell everyone in your country about me. Tell everyone in the whole world about me. And then he rose right up into heaven from that mountaintop. Now, God used these mountaintop experiences to speak to communicate with his people. And we may not have mountaintops in Illinois. We may be in a flat plain, but we can still have mountaintop experiences whenever we spend time with God and pray, more importantly, listen to. So let's pray now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your true words in your Bible. We thank you for you that you speak to us, whether we are on a mountaintop or in a flat plain. Help us to listen, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, may the healing, renewing, and transforming power of your word be at work in our lives today and always. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these words from the psalmist in Psalm 125. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time on and forevermore. For the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, so that the righteous may not stretch out their hands to do wrong. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good, and to those who are upright in their hearts. But those who turn aside to their own crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. This is the written word of God for all of God's people.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This month we're taking a look at what God has done through creation. Last week we looked at that give and take relationship of God with all of his creation, human and non-human alike. God created and thought all of his creation to be good, even peas. I don't like peas. I think God made a mistake there, but God didn't ask me. But God thought all of creation was good. And then he entrusted us with the responsibility to care for that creation. And today we look at the majesty of the mountains. I have to confess, I'm just fascinated with mountains, having been born in southeastern Iowa and raised in the Midwest, where only a curb breaks the horizon for the most part. I love the ocean, but you know what? Given a choice, I would love to go to the mountains. In vacations with family and friends in the past, I loved seeing the Alps. On my bucket list yet to see are the Canadian Rockies. I'm hoping to do that train ride through them. I loved seeing the Gilead mountain range in Israel, which divided the Mediterranean Sea coast from the Galilee district in the River Jordan, and seeing those seven mountains that comprise Jerusalem itself. When you think of those mountains, think of Pocono Mountains. They're well-worn and rounded, not huge and craggy like the Rocky Mountains. It's on Mount Zion where much of our scripture focuses and a lot of prophecy focuses, that is in the middle of those seven mountains of Jerusalem. It's the most important one, and yet it's not the highest one. But it's secure because it's surrounded by the other six mountains, as if those other six protect them. And it was on top of Mount Zion that our two temples had been built. You remember pictures of modern-day Jerusalem when you see the Gold Dome, which is an Islamic worship center, their third holiest worship site. That's got built on top of Mount Zion today. And it was near where Abraham was asked by God to sacrifice his son, Isaac. A handful of years ago, when my family and I went
Thanksgiving to celebrate with my dad and stepmother in their new vacation homes in Hot Springs Village, Arkansas. Never been there before, had no idea what to expect. The day after Thanksgiving, Dad and Judy took us on a windshield tour of Hot Springs Village, and we were in three different vehicles trailing one after another, and we ended up at a small little park, kind of a lookout site, if you will, from one of the mountains there in Hot Springs Village. They had told us about the history of the area. It was a place about 50 years ago where a developer came in and took land that they grew pine trees that are used to make telephone poles. And they flooded valleys and dammed them and created more lakes, and today it's a beautiful area. When we got out of the car at that lookout site, now I'm not prone to having these weird spiritual experiences, but I swear to God I heard the angels sing. I had this goofy look on my face, and my sister, who some of you met my first Sunday here, who's an RN, thought I was having a heart attack at the time. Now, as children, since we're only about 4 years apart in age, and occasionally because we shared a bedroom, we got into fights. And my dad turned around, and here I'm having this wonderful spiritual experience, and she's pounding on my back. And Dad went into dad mode and said, "Will you two cut that out?" Now, I knew that I was going to have a hard time explaining to my family about the hearing of the angels. They think I'm kind of off my rocker anyway most times. But I didn't think that was the appropriate time, so I just kind of fell into that joke and let them think that Gail and I were just being sisters. It was later on that when I had some private time with Dad and Judy that I shared with them how moved I was by the beauty of the area. And I had never begun thinking about where someday I might want to have a home. And I thought, would you mind if I eventually retired here? Now, they got excited and they thought I had applied for retirement right away. I said, well, that's not going to happen. But eventually, someday I'll be there. And it's because the mountains grew me. It's a place, like Barbara said, where God does business with God's people. You know, there's all types of mountains, gentle hills like the Poconos and the snow-covered rocky ranges like the Alps, the lush green mountains of Ireland, or the star-crabby mountains of Scotland where no goats or vegetation dare top them. But today, the psalm that we share is one of the psalms of ascent. When large families, extended communities, would make their annual pilgrimage to the temple in Jerusalem. First of all, it was not safe to travel in small groups or alone. So they would travel as communities, most on foot. And to pass the time, they would sing the Psalms of Ascent. And this is one of them. The topic being God and Mount Zion, their destination. The psalm speaks of Mount Zion as an illustration